This is, I think, very particular guitars. The 440 frequency does not work well. With violins, I think the same thing happens, but in the reverse, you don't want to go low, you want to go higher than 440. So different instruments have kind of these properties. We use the 440 as an arbitrary, as an arbitrary measure, a relative measure, so we can all kind of agree on something, but it's not exactly best. Shows, I mean, you know, the character, you're basically into the character of the piece immediately. Now, now I think you know, there are maybe a couple of thoughts that I would give you that I think are very, very important. One has to do with like just the overall aspect of performing, of playing.
Yeah.
The other one is actually mechanical, and the mechanical is kind of difficult, to explain, or actually maybe not so difficult to explain, but rather involved. So I'm going to begin just with the you know, with the one about performing. Okay. So now the way you're starting this, and the character is great, but the drive that the music has is not as present, you know, because the way you're playing kind of introspectively a great deal. You're pulling back a lot, you know. So now think about it this way. From now on, everything I'm going to say to you, I'm going to speak from the perspective of introspection. So as such, anything is pulled back. You see the the problem is that it almost, you know, it almost you know, as players, you know, as a performer, when you perform from that perspective, what I'm actually saying to you in this context becomes actually irrelevant. What becomes more relevant is my introspective personality. You see what I mean? So, for example, I think this music is very happy. You see the problem, right? And a performer is sort of the, you know, the player is actually sort of the vessel, the medium through which music flows, but he himself is not the one that needs to call attention. You know, so what we do is we play a piece, we feel its meaning, we try to ascertain what it is, but then we have to find a way to deliver that to a listener in a way that's clean enough where the listener can actually perceive the emotional content of the music. So, and of course for that you have some certain parameters. I mean, basically the parameters are all in the page that you see there. Now the page is, music is very ambiguous because notation is very ambiguous. So it's kind of like playing a game of clues. Basically trying to figure out what music is trying to say based on some clues. So you have this bass, you have a harmony, you have a rhythm, an overall rhythm, and you have a tempo and an instruction. You know, now these over here were not indicated, like the mezzo piano, mezzo forte, those types of things. Those are someone's conceptualization of what they believe this is. But notice that the music as a clue is not giving you that. It's just this is, we don't know if it's strong, we don't, you know, basically, what do you think this is? And you basically come up with something, you know. So the milonga tempo is a significant aspect because milongas are actually, they're kind of slow, somewhat introspective dances, but they are steady. So, and that is not something that's, you know, so if you actually use that, you can see that, you know, in spite of the character of the piece, there's actually kind of a constant motion forward in it. And the way you're playing it, you're kind of slowing down, you know, so so you actually need to keep it going, for example. I mean, that's one example in this case, right? So let's actually try to do that. And also, once again, you know, in your case, this idea of making sure that all the notes are clear, like I mentioned before, is, you know, it has some relevance, but not as much. I mean, you know, because you're going to have to figure out levels and such. But right now, let's actually aim for that. Let's not worry about these dynamic indications, and see what happens if you just play. Yeah. Now that's pretty fast, but that's about the tempo, right?
Okay. This is 84, right? 84.
That's about the tempo, right? Yet. So in any case, and if I were you, you borrow your guitar just so I have a sense of what you're actually, what kind of sound you're going to use. So to me, the things that are attractive here, that bass, the starting bass, so that's also attractive to me, the fact that you're that high dissonance degree. So then this. I would try not to be as introspective about it. I would just try to be more open. And of course, that is more of an issue. At that point, that becomes more of an issue of like character, how I'm viewing the character. And that is something that I think is more up to you than me. Like, mine is just an opinion. So you know, in that case, I mean, the way you're playing that is beautiful. The issue is, it's always in the same direction. Use rhythm as a way to control your natural propensity to slow down. So, so basically, you want to slow down, but the music won't let you. Think of it that way, you know. And so those are the things that I would focus on particularly for as far as playing. The other thing that you have to consider is that, you know, if you play quietly, people won't be able to hear you. So that's another final concern for anything that you do. Typically, you know, when in this melody type situations, I also focus on color of sound and such. But you know, instead of just following harmony or use harmony, but use some take advantage of the moments when you have more beautiful situations that you can play. For example, this kind of thing. You could play, you can use that old targa technique of playing rest strokes here for the melody, and then everything else with free strokes. I don't know if that's a technique that you've worked on before, but if not, have you? Or?
I don't know, I think.
Okay, so give it a try and see. Be able to use a restroom one because then this one will disappear, but and probably after that will, because of that, then these can be free strokes again, you know, so that would be a way to apply that sort of technique. But there's something good that comes out of that, and that is that because the restroom has a very distinctive quality of sound, then you can actually play this stronger and they will not commingle, they will separate. So, and right now you're playing this a bit on the soft side, so can you try that again and just play it a bit stronger? it's, I'm gonna try a little game, I don't know if it's gonna work. But I'm gonna be your right hand and you're gonna be my left. So let's try this, same place. How much sound there is in the accompaniment, as opposed to the melody itself. Well, I played kind of too strongly, right? But you know, just so don't separate so much on the, don't ignore the accompaniments. You know, they're very, very important. You know, so anyway, that was the first particular thing that I was going to suggest about the overall character of execution that could be stronger. You know. Now, let me point out a couple of things here, also from the same direction. Could you play anywhere here, maybe? So what do you make of those chords, for example? Yeah, very they're very reflexive, you know, so you have this so it sounds to me like you're not sure what their reason of being. And to be honest, I don't really know what the reason of being is there. I don't know why they're there. But I know that the fact that they are different from everything else that you've done is significant. You know, so as such, and this is actually one of those things that as a performer you have to also like figure out. You know, sometimes you have material that you don't understand. It seems out of, it's like, oh, this doesn't fit with anything else that I've seen. So, you know, oftentimes we just think, oh, I don't know what to do, so I'm just going to play it like quietly, you know. But instead, what I would do is the opposite. You know, wait a second, the fact that that's there, and that it doesn't seem to make any sense with respect to the other part, is saying that this is somehow significant, you know, because it really is going to distinguish itself. So let's make sure that it appears. Let's make sure that people know that this appeared, and it's not, it's deliberately different. And let them figure out what it is. it's a very important thing that, once again, this idea of being a performer or the interpreter, you know, you are looking to transmit and let people actually interpret what they're hearing. You're not actually the interpreter, you're the medium. You're basically communicating the musical thoughts in as clear or concise a manner as you can, and then as people listen, they're going to think and reflect and derive meanings from what's happening. That's sort of the power that music has. So here, I would basically just play. And maybe even, I could even do this. One was more sensitive, right? Or maybe the opposite. Yeah, so all these are directions, but they're, you know, like I said, it's not that I know what the exact answer is. Like, you know, I can't really claim it. And incidentally, the composer cannot claim it himself. You know, once the piece is written, the composer has his own view about it. But But there is no, but his is just one interpretation as well. You know, so, and, but what you're looking for, what makes the difference is the fact that I'm trying to come up with something that's effective from a listening perspective. You know, so instead of, it's not clear enough to a listener. What happened? What, you know, this sounded different. I mean, it was so quiet. What happened? You know, but if I make a point, of, that's exaggeration. But you know, in any case, something that makes sense. You know, that's audible enough will always make sense. So those are the types of things that that you can think about. Now, I'll tell you one little secret that I. It's not a secret. I tell everybody this, but you know, let's just say it's a secret. You know, when in doubt about music, meaning you don't know what it means, the last thing you want to do is play quietly. You know, when in doubt, just say it for what it is. You know, and it's very, you know, if you're reading something and what you're reading doesn't make sense to you, you know, you have two options. You spend some time trying to figure out what it actually says, or you communicate it to someone else who maybe understands the meaning better and can tell you, right? So as a performer, you kind of have the same thing. If you're not really clear as to what it is, instead of playing quietly, you want to play it following the very simple rules of notes and rhythm, notes and note values. So here, all you had was this, 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 and you had that rhythm. Da, 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 da. And then you look for, okay, what's coherent? Is this, I have to play that, there's going to be a break, so how do I, maybe I can do this. For example, you know, so I'm basically looking for something that allows these notes to speak, and I'm not going to be too worried about what they mean. Yeah. Over time, I might think about it differently, and then I'll do something else. But if I'm in doubt, I'll just let the notes speak for themselves. Yeah, so that's how I tell my students that if you're in doubt, let the notes speak for themselves. Just play them, and you know, over time, you yourself are going to understand something about them. But in any case, anyone listening is going to have to struggle with the same issue of meaning. You know, so they have to figure out what it is as well. So in any case, that's that. Now there was the mechanical issue that I wanted to talk to you about, and this is kind of complex. So we're gonna give it a try. Do you know what fingering patterns are?
I have heard the term.
Okay. Let me see if I can come up with an example. Are you familiar with the Lowe's Etude number one? Okay. The one that goes. Have you ever looked at it or tried to play it? What about this? Are you familiar with this? Okay. So, have you tried to play that?
No.
Oh, you should. Do you like the piece? So then, you know, this is a suggestion for everyone. If you like something, don't wait for your teacher to tell you to play it. You know, just grab the music and see what you can make of it. Now, some teachers really hate that, so sorry about those of you teachers who are trying to get your students not to do that. But my feeling is that these types of pieces that we like are the very reason why we actually come back to the guitar, because we envision ourselves at some point trying to play something like that. It's like, when I grow up, I'm going to play this piece, that sort of thing, in guitar years, that is. But if a teacher says no, you can't play that. Oh no, my dreams were crushed. So don't feel that way. If you like the piece and you have a curiosity for what it is and you're hoping that at some point you're going to be able to play it, just you know, get the music and see if you can make something. If you can make sense of the piece, if you can't make sense of the piece, then okay. So now at least you know that you have something to look forward to. So now you're ready. Your thought about, oh, I want to grow up and be able to play this piece becomes, I want to grow up and be able to make sense of that piece, you know, or make sense of what it says, you know, that sort of thing. But in any case, I'm going to use that one as an example because you know it. That piece is basically this. You have a melody here. And you have one note that accompanies it. And they are interspersed. So you have one melody note, then followed by one accompanying note, and this is constantly alternating. I'm describing the piece for those of you who, in case some of you don't actually know the mechanical aspects of the piece. So, melodies in the bass, so that's a thumb, and then accompaniments in the treble string, so that's going to be at least one thing. So, the first one would be index, so. And so that's what that is. That interaction of thumb and the finger is what we know as a finger, what we call a fingering pattern. Now, why is it a pattern? Well, because it's repetitive. Yeah, you can actually understand what it is. And from there, you can emanate other types of patterns that are more complex. So the standard fingering pattern for Asturias, in this case, is not P-I-P-I or P-M-B-M, but it's actually P-I-P-M. So that's two separate set patterns that are now fused to make a larger pattern. You know, those are called concatenations, if you're curious. But and what it is that basically you have a PI that now alternates with a PN. So you have alternation of two fingers here, and then you have alternation of thumb and a finger. And it creates a different volume sound, as opposed to or. So notice how PI is kind of harsh. So the typewriter sound. Then you have the sweeter PM. And then you have the intense PIPM. See, so that's typically the one that's used. Segovia's edition had it. And so those are the types of things that we call fingering patterns. You know, and so fingering patterns are formed basically based on these principles of actions, you know, like a thumb and a finger or alternations of fingers. And you know, they're basically what I said, basic forms, like simple alternations between thumb and fingers. And then from there you can create more complex structures. The Villalobos Etude 1 is a concatenation of several aspects of alternation. So you have the basic, as stated by Villalobos, was P-I, P-I, P-M. Now this follows this. A, M to I and then to A. And then from here, M, A, I, M, and then back to B-I, P-I. So there are several groups. That's what that is. It's basically a chain of little events that are taking place. Okay. Now, once you get to the piumoso section, this piumoso section is operating on some of the basic fingering set patterns that we have, which would.